Hello friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Today let's see current affairs of 3rd August 2018. The topics we are going to cover today includes these five. Let's see them in detail. The first topic is regarding the new e-commerce policy of the government. In order to regulate the e-commerce industry, the government has come up with new draft e-commerce policy. The draft policy will now be studied by a 70-member think tank in order to devise the final draft policy. As we all know, there is massive increase in the growth of e-commerce sector in our country. From fashion industry to pharmaceuticals, almost all the sectors are covered by e-commerce. The e-commerce business now is around $25 billion and it is expected to increase to almost $200 billion by 10 years. This is because of the cheap cost of the smartphones, cheaper data access, and also growing spending trends among almost all the people. This e-commerce policy is very important in the light of increasing mergers between the foreign companies and the Indian e-commerce sectors. For example, the proposed merger between Flipkart and the Walmart calls for specific guidelines regulating the e-commerce sector. Now let's see some of the points regarding the draft policy. The draft policy talks about the pricing strategies. This pricing strategy is aimed to create balance between the local vendors on one hand and the big e-commerce sector vendors on the other. The sunset clause of the draft policy talks about the maximum duration of providing the discounts. It also has a special clause called as inventory model, which talks about the FDI investment in the e-commerce sector. It also proposes to create special relaxations to the goods which are specially made in India. The draft policy also seeks to create a single national level regulator to regulate the e-commerce sector. The Enforcement Directorate will look into the violations of the draft policy, and the Competition Commission of India will look into the matters concerning distorting competition violation. The policy also talks about data localization. It seeks to store the data generated within the country, within India, and the government can use such data for the purpose of national security, public policy, privacy, and also for consent. However, no policy comes without limitations. Let's see the limitations of this draft e-commerce policy. First one is regarding the sunset clause. The sunset clause talks about the restrictions with regard to licensing and the price control. This may depress the economic growth of the sector concerned. The foreign direct investment restrictions on the players in the e-commerce sector may also be considered as a regressive step, as it may block the incoming foreign direct investment into the country and thus affecting the growth of the sector. It must also be noted that India has a retail FDI policy and government is facing problems in monitoring the policy, and the same problems can appear even with regard to the monitoring of this policy also. This graph shows the increasing trend of the e-commerce sales in India. In the year 2015, it was only $12 billion, and in the year 2021, it is expected to increase up to $45 billion. With respect to the data localization condition proposed in this policy, the e-tailer cost across the country is also projected to increase, and this will be reflected in the prices of the goods sold in the e-commerce sector. The government's plan to stipulate the use of RuPay cards for payment is questioned by both consumers and the firms. Operationalizing all the policies of this e-commerce policy will require actions from multiple ministries and regulators, which may cause confusion. While this e-commerce policy will definitely benefit the local vendors, on the other hand, it may affect some other sectors. These restrictions brought in by this e-commerce policy could drive away those who are planning to invest in the online retail sector, and this will also take away opportunity to create new jobs in the market. This diagram shows some of the challenges faced by the e-commerce in India. Number one is low internet penetration. Though the internet penetration has considerably increased in the past few years, still some areas in the rural pockets do not have internet penetration. Infrastructure and logistical inadequacies. This is especially important in hilly sector and northeastern part of our country. Strong offline shopping culture. Still, many Indians prefer to go directly to the shop and buy things instead of buying it online. This may also be attributed to lack of awareness about the e-commerce sector. Other challenges include challenges in achieving profitability of the e-commerce sector and the dominance of cash-based transactions in India. The second topic we are going to see is about SC-ST Amendment Act. The government has proposed to bring in the amendment to the SC-ST Act in the light of the recent judgment by the Supreme Court. The recent few days has seen widespread protest by the scheduled caste people in order to bring in amendments to the Scheduled Caste Act. The Supreme Court's judgment few days ago brought in the following changes to the 1989 law. The 1989 Act provided a bar on giving anticipatory bail. However, the recent Supreme Court judgment took away the anticipatory bail ban and proposed granting advance bail if there is no merit on the complaint. The second change is the arrest can be made only if the appointing authority gives permission in the case of public servants. And the third change made by the Supreme Court is there must be compulsory preliminary inquiry into the complaints before registration of the FIRs. This is especially to prevent false complaints on innocent people. This chart shows the conviction rate among the SC-ST people in our country. The conviction rate among SC cases is very low at 23.9% and among the IPC cases also, the conviction rate stands low at around 38%. And this conviction rate is even lower among some states like UP, Rajasthan, whereas it is better off in other states like Orissa. This verdict on the SC-ST case recently by the Supreme Court has projected multiple interpretations by different groups differently. Some of these are deliberately misinterpreted. With the National Crime Records Bureau data showing very low conviction rate among Dalits, this protest stand even further aggravated. However, it must be seen that the judgment did not alter or read down any of the key provisions of the Act, but it just provided more clauses in order to prevent the false cases. The proposed amendment by the government must keep in concern two important clauses. A law made must maintain a proper balance of protecting the rights of the affected party and also protecting a fair trial to the convicted person. The amendment must also protect the dignity of the disadvantaged class who has been facing discrimination for several years. The third issue we are going to see is with respect to Bandipur Wildlife Sanctuary. The Ministry of Road Transport and Highways has proposed to lift the ban on night traffic through the Bandipur Wildlife Sanctuary. This Bandipur Wildlife Sanctuary is also a tiger reserve. The National Tiger Conservation Authority has given that wildlife animals such as tigers, elephants, goose, and other animals are behaviorally adjusted to restricted traffic during the night time. If this alteration is made, according to Ministry of Road Transport and Highways proposed, this may lead to long-term conservation effects on these species. This issue throws into light the man-animal conflict that has been going on in our country. The man-animal conflict is due to the growing human population and the overlap of increasing human dominance over the wildlife territory. This may be due to grazing or increased mining or dam construction, etc. The effect of the man-animal conflict may lead to loss of life or injury for both human beings and the animals. It may also lead to competition for scarce resources and loss and degradation of the habitat which are presently existing. The man-animal conflict is increasing issue especially in the areas of Western Ghats, Central India in Kanha Wildlife Sanctuary. The conflict has led to considerable crop loss on one hand and it has also increased the livestock loss on the other hand. Some of the states facing this man-animal conflict includes Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, etc. For the prelims perspective, one has to know about National Tiger Conservation Authority. The National Tiger Conservation Authority is a statutory body. It is set up under the regulation of Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. This body was given a statutory status in the year 2006 under the Amendment of Wildlife Protection Act 1986. Project Tiger is a special scheme to protect the tiger species in our country. It is a centrally sponsored scheme which provides funding for the support of the tiger range states to provide in-situ conservation of the tigers. The government has designated many important tiger areas as tiger reserves in India. We have to know the tiger reserves areas and the states they are located in for the prelims exam. Some of the tiger reserves in India are Jim Corbett, Dudhwa, Sariska, Satyadri, Nagarjun Sagar, Indravati, Simlipal, Sundarbans, Dampa, Nagarhol, Bandipur, Anaimuri, Mudumalai, etc. The fourth issue deals with the adultery law existing in our country. The adultery law violates the dignity of women. This is the statement given by the Supreme Court of our country. Section 497 of Indian Penal Code defines adultery. According to it, a man could be punished up to 5 years in jail if he has sexual intercourse with another man's wife. This adultery law is punishing only men and it does not talk about the consent given by women. The whole adultery law sees women as a property of man. This seeing of women as personal possession of man is against the right to equality and right to dignity of women, which is a basic fundamental right according to our Indian Constitution. According to Supreme Court, adultery must be seen as a breakdown in the institution of marriage, and the institution of marriage consists of two pillars, and both the parties, men and women, must be considered equally responsible for the adultery. This adultery law not just violates the dignity of women according to Article 21, but it also stands against Article 14, the right to equality, and Article 15, prohibition of grounds of discrimination based on caste, religion, and sex of Indian Constitution. The previous governments has failed to change this IPC session, saying that the change will take away the sanctity of marital bond. However, with a recent Malamed Committee report on reforms on criminal justice system, the government has agreed to look into the issue and bring in an amendment in the adultery law. The last topic we are going to see is with respect to the cybercrime. Beware of the SMS on the IT refunds. For the past couple of years, the cyber crimes in India and all over the world has exponentially increased. The new cybercrime racket, which is recently discovered, sends text messages to people posing as Income Tax Department. The message tells that income tax refund has been approved to some random bank account number, and in case of the account number being wrong, one must click the link and change the account number to one's own bank number in order to get the refund. Once the link is clicked, a malicious web page is opened and it may lead to cybercrime. This new cybercrime racket which came up covers almost all of India. And these false messages can trigger data theft and even banking fraud accounting to lot of money. The other type of cyber attacks which India has been facing recently includes ransomware attack, wherein a person is asked to pay a ransom in order to access one's own data. WannaCry and Petya, they are also types of ransomware, and crypto worms using cryptographic technology to take away one's data, and denial of service attacks, especially in things dealing with Internet of Things. There is also increasing trend in attack of the government sites apart from individual and institutional sites. This chart shows the increasing cyber attacks in our country. From 2016 to 2017, the cyber attacks has almost doubled in online banking sector, and the other sectors that face cyber attacks include email hacking, sexual assault of women, data theft, job theft, theft involving Twitter and other social media sites. Thank you.